Science for Everyday Decisions, series by Center for Sustainable Development at the Earth Institute, Columbia University. For your consideration for a more sustainable life through education for sustainable development.
So thanks, Subhajoy, for joining us today. It's really a pleasure. Just to give a background to everyone, Subhajoy Roy is a journalist with the City Bureau, Kolkata, of the Telegraph East, which is Eastern India's largest circulated English daily, and it's very, very reputed. He's been working there for 10 years. And on normal days, he covers air quality issues, civic issues like waste management, water supply, health, and a lot of climate-related work. But these days he's covering COVID-19 in Kolkata. So it will be good to hear both sides on his normal day, normal routine with the Telegraph, and then on COVID-19, how have things changed? What is his opinion and how is the city reacting to this? And plus, how has this changed Subhajoy's work with the Telegraph, and what is the general scenario there and thinking there. So it's a great pleasure to have you, and I hope to have a great session, and thank you for joining today, Subhajoy. Over to you.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Yeah, the thing is, you told me that I should give a little bit about what generally is a journalist's life or the usual time. So it's like, we, as a reporter, many of you would know that for journalists, there are two things, like either you're a desk person or you're a reporter. Reporters go out in the field, they report, they talk to people, collect information, and that's it. So the desk people stay back in office. They do the page making, they produce the newspaper, which even for the television channels, there are desk and there are reporters. So they do the production work in-house. And the product that we finally see on the television screen or what we see in the newspaper, that is done by the desk people. So for I'm a reporter. So for me, usually on a normal day, my day starts around 12:31. We go to office, there is a meeting. Initially, first 1-2 hours, there's actually, very honestly, not too much of work if it's a non-event day. If there is event, that can happen anytime, early in the morning, 9 a.m., 8 a.m., whatever it is. So usually the government people or even people in private companies, they start talking from 4:30, 3:35, because that's when they end their work and they are in a position to talk. And that's when we go in. I cover the municipal corporation. So the city's mayor, sometimes he briefs. If there is something important to say, he calls us over to his office and he tells us what to do, what the decisions taken in that day's meeting. So then we go to the respective department officers, talk to them to know things in little more detail. And then we come back to office and write it. And the just collecting the information and writing it, it's not actually that easy, because in between this, our collection of information and what is produced in the newspaper, there is a lot of steps which happens. There's the editor, there's the chief of bureau who would decide on how to pitch the story, how to have the peg, which of the information should come first, and how to relate it with other things, give the background, analyze it, all those things. So if things are normal, we get over with our work at 9:30, 10 at night, and then come back home. Desk usually stays back for a very, very long time. In our office, even the editor stays back till 3:30 in the morning. He actually makes the paper go to bed and then comes out of office. So that's it. But nowadays, COVID-19, what has happened is we have been asked, even in fact, all the print media reporters in Calcutta, I don't know about other parts of India, are working from home. They have been strictly told not to go out since we have the scope of working from home, talking to people over phone. And good thing is, even both the government of India and the state government, the state where I live, they are putting out a lot of information on the website, the circulars and everything, which is becoming easier, which is easier for us to track. In usual circumstances, the governments in India are very miser in sharing information. They want to keep everything in custody, but at least the advisories and those things are now out. But then there are allegations of suppression of cases, actual deaths, all those things, as I asked you whether it's the same thing there also. So now what we are doing, we're tracking the advisories, the guidelines that are being issued daily. Then if there is something interesting, we're talking to our seniors in office over phone. If they say, yeah, this is a story. So then trying to talk to Department of Health officials, doctors, public health experts from various groups, agencies, because naturally those who work with the state health department, they're very busy now. They have to do all the tracking, the patients, their contacts, all those things. So they're remaining busy. So based on the official information, whatever the government is putting out, then we are going out and reaching out to people in private institutions. A lot of public health organizations are there. Then there are hospitals where there are good doctors, well-known doctors. We're talking to them, trying to understand what does that mean? What does this guideline mean? Whether it will actually be very practical to implement on ground, and then writing it. So it is work from home, but it has actually become more difficult now, more so because all of you would know that what is happening in COVID-19 is, suppose there is a positive case today from any part of Calcutta. So that person is shifted to hospital. Now the real difficult task for us begins, as well as for the health department. The health department starts tracking how many people came in contact with him or her. So it's a very tedious and very difficult task. The doctors who go and treat that person, they are given a list of questionnaires that you ask these things to the patient, try to know from him as much detail as possible, that he went to these places between the time he got his fever and between the time he came to hospital, how many people he came in contact with, ask him. Then health department officials talk to them over phone, which are the places you went to, remember which are the people you met, what kind of proximity you had with them, how close you went to them, was there a physical?
To trace the number of people a person from Calcutta meets, it's going to be impossible, because obviously in a day you meet so many people. How does that
work? Yes, so far what I have realized is they're trying to do that. I'll give you an example. The longest contact list I have come to know of till now is a person who tested positive. The health department prepared a contact list of 442 people. So he had traveled in a train from New Delhi to Calcutta, and then he went to a district of West Bengal, so through a passenger train. So they spoke to him repeatedly. Then the railway agency gave the health department the ticket number, the passenger list of that train. So they had to individually call all those people. Where are you? Stay in home quarantine, because one of the person you traveled with has tested positive. So, but then these are probably needed. If these people who are being asked to stay in home quarantine, if they follow, then the risk of spread reduces. Then there is a chance that you are able to contain the spread. Now, it is their job, they are doing it. What becomes difficult for us is to get the authentic information, which I have repeatedly raised with the state health department, that there should be one officer who is designated to speak to us every day, who will give us out these informations, like how many contact people have been traced for one positive case. So this is the kind of mechanism that is being followed to contain this disease. And the strategy that I will say India has taken through this lockdown is, which I'm not very sure you would be in a better position to tell me, the criticism about United States or many of the Western countries is that the lockdown, they did the lockdown at a time when things had already gone out of control. Or maybe the basic human rights and other rights are so rigid and strong there that, I mean, just enforcing a lockdown is a little difficult there, which is easier in India. If the prime minister thinks, no, this is needed, he'll just talk to the chief ministers and do it. So the strategy they have taken, what I have understood so far after talking to the doctors and public health people here, is India realized that we don't have enough resources to conduct tests. That the kind of population we have, 130 crore people, we cannot go on aggressive testing the way many Western nations, or which South Korea has done. South Korea has been credited to have done a very good job. So India realized we cannot go for such massive and aggressive tests. So they stopped all international flights from March 22, which even now I don't think United States or United Kingdom has stopped. Even today I saw that the British Deputy High Commissioner in Calcutta, he has tweeted a picture of he is present in the airport and arranging those British people who are stuck in Calcutta to put them onto the next flight back to London. And it's the same thing with USA also. They have not yet stopped international flights. So there is also there's a debate like whether a government can actually tell its people that I won't allow you to come home if you're in trouble, which is something many people are saying against the government here, that if I'm an Indian in trouble in any part of the world, can the government tell me, no, I won't allow you to come to my country because you may be a carrier of this virus and you will spread it. But then the government of India decided that we will not allow any international flight from March 22. So they stopped it. Even Indians are not allowed to come to India now. The logic behind this was we realized we don't have enough resources. We don't have, if the virus spreads very rapidly, the kind number of people who needs hospitalization will be completely out of control. We won't be able to give so many hospital beds. So the lockdown was done to prevent the spread as much as possible. So you suppose there are carriers within the community already. If I allowed a free movement of people to all places, what would have happened is they would go from place A to place B to place C to place D, and this way they would go on spreading the virus. By lockdown, what the government did is I ensured that even if you spread it within a very small area. You don't spread it to across the state, or you don't spread it to across the country, which then would become very, very difficult to trace. So they did it. And now we have come to a situation where we are reaching the end of the lockdown period. Usually doctors are saying this disease is an incubation period of 14 days. So if you say that from March 22, we are going towards the end of the 14-day period. So the symptoms will start emerging from now. And it is expected if I have the symptom, I won't stay back at home. I will run to a hospital because I will realize that if this can become very dangerous and fatal also. So as people start arriving in hospitals, then more tests will be done. As naturally more tests will reveal more positive cases, the numbers will rise. Doctors will say this is inevitable. It will happen. Don't panic over that. But what the government is trying to do now is what they got by doing the lockdown is a time to respond. They have arranged hospitals. They have arranged quarantine centers. They have arranged at least the number of kits needed for tests, which was very low in the initial phase, that have increased. Many private corporations have been authorized to manufacture the kits. Now there are more kits in the market. So now we are in a situation where we can at least deal with more cases. If there are positive cases, the doctor will see that this person needs hospitalization. Okay, put him to hospital. This person doesn't need hospitalization, though he or she is a positive patient. Put him at home and tell him or her to follow these steps. Because they are saying that if it doesn't affect your kidney or your lungs, it is just like any other viral fever. You stay at home and you'll get cured. Nothing to fear. So this, I will say from the government's side, this has been a logical decision, knowing our restraint, knowing that we don't have enough resources to conduct tests, we don't have enough hospital beds. If the virus spreads rapidly, if more and more and huge number of people get affected, we won't be able to contain it. Uh-huh. So now they have made hospitals. Now we are in a, like today, the chief secretary of the government of West Bengal announced we in West Bengal, the state where I live, there are 59 hospitals dedicated only to treat patients of COVID-19. And there are about 500 quarantine centers built by the state government. So we are in a position to respond at least. This doesn't guarantee that we'll do well. Still, things can go out of hand completely. So this is what I understood was the logic behind doing this lockdown.
Mm-hmm. So how does your day-to-day look like right now? Do you have to wear mask and talk to people? Are you allowed to talk to people as a journalist, or are you going to the hospitals? How safe is it for you to conduct your writing and other things with the work?
No, as I said before also, like those who work in the print media, they have been told to work from home since it's television journalists have to go out. They have to, because it's there is no way out for them. We can talk to people over phone and then write it based on the conversation over phone, which is the advantage we have. Congregation of more than five people is not allowed legally. So we are not going out. We are working from home. We are trying to talk to public health experts, to doctors, to people in the health department, and the state government is doing a press conference every day in the afternoon where they're giving out figures of how many people have been infected today, how many deaths, how many people in home quarantine, how many people have been sent, released from home quarantine, how many people in government set up quarantine, all those figures they are giving. And then we are going, asking them questions, and based on that, television journalists, yes, they're doing a far more risky job than we are. They are going to the hospitals, they are going to all places, they're reporting how things are, even whether it's good, whether it's bad. That is the present scenario here right now.
And is there like an online tracking of COVID-19 cases? Because here apparently there is a couple of websites where you can see, you know, where there is a big bubble or small bubble, how these states are doing, how many cases are. So you get a sense, like the mayor of my city, my town, she sends out an email or a message every week to show the number of cases, to see how they're tackling and what are their strategies. So is there something like this on a weekly basis in Calcutta?
No. At least not from the government side. I'm not sure whether any scientific research institute or any private organization is doing it, but at least not from the government side. But just today, the government announced that we are starting the cluster and hotspot tracking. We are trying to identify the clusters and the hotspots where there is a risk of more number of cases emerging in the next few days. So then again, what will be done is, I spoke to a public health expert. He said when you identify a cluster or a hotspot, the thing is you start active medical surveillance. Medical teams will go door to door and ask people, do you have fever? Do you have cough? Do you have respiratory distress? Any symptom, which in other case would have been still told that wait for another 2 days, any symptom emerges, you will be asked to come to a hospital, test yourself. So now they will go for this aggressive testing in those small neighborhoods where they think it is a cluster or it's a hotspot from where cases may emerge.
Is it okay to take questions in between, maybe? Because I think...
Yeah.
I wanted to ask about the government, if they're doing anything to try to help people who aren't able to work right now, because our federal government just passed a package for $1,200 each, and then if they have kids, they get more, and there's small business loans and things like that to help people who aren't able to work right now. Is the government there doing anything like that?
You're asking that whether the government is doing or giving any monetary benefit or food supply to the daily wage earners?
Anything along those lines, whether it's distributing
Yes, they are doing. Not for the salaried people, but then those are daily wage earners. Like those who work in domestic households, those who do daily chores, yes, they are doing it. And also the government, yes, tell me.
Like, what does that look like? Do police or military go around and distribute food, or what's the process?
Police is doing it, and then the local municipal corporation is doing it, which is the urban local body, in our city at least. Primarily these two organizations, the police and the local municipal corporation, they are going to places, they're handing over food, cereals, rice, basic vegetables, which are needed on a day-to-day basis or 1 or 2 days in between, I mean gaps of 1 or 2 days. And also I think the government has started a scheme of transferring money to bank accounts of people who are daily wage earners and who also have a bank account.
Wow.
Nidhi, I think you have your hand up. Meanwhile, some others are saying that the link is asking them to go to a Columbia University website. I think because of the Zoom issue, there might be some other restrictions that we are not aware of. So anyway, we'll continue our discussion. But you guys didn't have any issues, right?
I did see an article, though, where new meetings will need to have a password.
Yeah.
But meetings already scheduled are like grandfathered in.
But there are some people who are trying to join, and they've been directed to our IT website or something. So problems, what's happening, we'll have to check that out. I think okay.
Subhajoy, thank you for joining us. And it was very good to hear all the things that you mentioned. So my question was that you mentioned that print journalists are not allowed to step out. So why should I believe any of this print journalism? Because that means it's a very secondary journalism that you're doing, right? You're not at the ground seeing and reporting firsthand. And we know that the current government in India is extremely infamous for its media sell, for concocting even videos and all the sound bites and all the news. So why should that mean actually there is no real journalism? Because if the real journalists are not going out and all we are seeing is video footages being created by whoever, that really doesn't let me trust the media as much then.
No, I would like to correct one thing, that there's no government order on print journalists cannot go out. This is something which our offices have told us. So at least in Calcutta, I can say that the major newspaper journalists, most of them are working from home. In our paper, most are working from home, not all. Some are going out, the photographers are going out, some reporters are going out. So that is, the government has not said that media people cannot go out. Government has actually given a notification where they have kept media, both print and electronic, in the category of essential service providers who are allowed to go out.
Okay, so what even standard reputed print media, like the Telegraph, can it not send its field reporters, you know, wearing a Telegraph badge, out and report from the field?
Some people are going out, like the people who cover the state secretariat, where mostly the official meetings are taking place, where the figures, where the press conferences are being held, where the numbers are being given out, they are going. Hospitals, till some time back we were going, but we are not going any longer, very true. But then even if you go, in this kind of a situation, what is happening is you won't be able to speak to patients or their family members, because the family members are not being allowed to come to the hospital, anywhere near to the hospital or near the patient. The patients are completely isolated. So you won't be allowed to go anywhere near them. What we are trying to do is, through our sources or through the people we know, we are trying to reach out to them through phone numbers or other means, and then trying to talk to them whether they feel that the management of the disease or the management in the hospitals are proper, it's happening properly, or people who are in home quarantine. Like I did a story of people who are in home quarantine. So we are talking to them that the protocol says the government will call you every day and tell you what to do, what not to do, whether you have fever, take information from you, whether that is being followed. And there's also a thing like the first 14 days, they're calling it active surveillance period. And the next 14 days, they're calling it passive surveillance period. During active surveillance, it is the government officers who are supposed to call a suspect or a patient, not a patient, someone who is in home quarantine. And then the passive surveillance period, it is the person's responsibility to get back to the government in case he or she develops any symptom. So I asked them whether they got that thing clarified very well, but most of them said, no, this was not explained to us very clearly that what we are supposed to do after 14 days. So those things we are reporting, but print journalists, I will admit that most of them are doing it from home. Your question is valid, but right now I won't be able to give an answer to that question. Television journalists are going out. Even the print report is going out, all papers.
Yeah, I mean, at least I haven't heard of any journalists being actively told not to go out. So there's a standard order and we still have reporting being done constantly. I never questioned to ask where are these journalists getting this report from, because I believe that, you know, it's all, they're actually going out and doing. Nobody has told us that print journalists are not going, but media journalists are, you know, people with cameras are allowed, video cameras, not normal cameras at all. Because the point, especially in India, is that, you know, if most of you, and this is not just about, you know, I'm not talking about personally you. So please don't take it anyway way. I'm just talking. Because, you know, media, unfortunately, has acquired such a dubious reputation in India right now that, especially in a national emergency like this, there is so much chance for creating all the false propaganda that can be created by powers that are vested with the power, right? So I feel that in a situation like that, where, you know, in overnight you say, okay, everything locks down, and now you can talk to people, these are the numbers I'm providing. Whose numbers are these? I mean, if all we are doing is talking on the telephone to certain numbers that's given to us, we'll always get the most rosy picture of what's happening in the country there. You know, in fact, the majority of India, which will actually be bearing the brunt of this, will probably not have a phone to start with, or number two, will have their telephones confiscated in the first round. And by this, I mean even the communal tinge there is to Indian polity right now. So if all that doesn't get reported, I feel then, you know, there is little for us to believe in the in journalism at this point. Because the task of journalism is to be out there and, you know, just like doctors, they just have to be out there and risk it all and get it out for us, for the rest of us. And this is just like, this is just something that I feel, but I mean, I don't know, would I have done it? I don't know. And so anybody who's not doing it, that's perfectly fine. It's just a general comment on journalism in India right now. And you could speak to that.
If you just elaborate it a little more, like, what I'm trying to understand is what kind of stories you feel that we will be missing out if you're not going, apart from talking to people in communities and then asking them whether someone else asked that whether there is any commitment from the government to people who are poor, who are daily wage earners, whether the government is doing anything from them. Yes, this is one place where I won't be able to know anything if I don't go out and talk to them. Whether the government is actually giving you the food that it has promised, whether the government is actually giving you daily staff that it has promised and or not. This is something which we will miss. So what are the other things you're saying that we will, because in terms of numbers or in terms of what are the new testing facilities that were being inaugurated and the other, even if we went out, there was no way to, say, for example, the government has set up a new testing center. The only way to get the information of how many tests they can conduct in a day, or what is the capacity, how many kids they have received, the only way to get it was again from the head of the institution or from the government sources. The head of the institution can still be contacted over phone. I'm not challenging you, but I'm just trying to understand that what the views you have.
Huh. Right. I think because I'm so invested in what is happening in India in the current and the recent context, so perhaps my fears are far more than just COVID. I feel that in the name of quarantine, there could just be simple selective plucking of a population out of the mainstream. That, you know, hey, these are, like, for instance, we know what is happening in Delhi right now. Delhi, that, yes. You know, there was this Nizamuddin Mosque scenario, and then it got an entire, corona became a very, very communal concept. And so now, I mean, who is to say that in Uttar Pradesh, there will not be, in UP, there will not be selective handpicking of a minority in the name of, like, you know, oh, these people have corona because obviously they went there, so let's pick them all up, and they're gone, and they're in quarantine, but we know that there are the alleged detention centers and so on. So I mean, these kind of things, when you think about it, so much could be done in the name of, because this is the ideal situation right now. You know, you isolate, you don't allow people out, you're not even allowing journalists out. So you have actually a field day. The power can have a field day. This is just a point that I wanted to throw out. I absolutely, respect most of the journalists who are working there. But I feel there is this, a grain of salt that we are required to now take everything with. But we can move on to it, because this can, I think, go on forever.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, Nidhi. This is Shahana here. I was in the Eco Ambassador talk a couple of weeks ago, if you remember, on climate.
Yes.
Yeah. So Subhajoy is a friend, and I'm very happy to also attend his talk as well and listen to your concerns. Can I also address your concerns? Can I just take a minute to address your concerns? Yeah. So there are two sets of news gathering that's happening now. One is data journalism, for which you would absolutely need to be on your computer and on your desk. And these are the reporters who are sort of gathering data on the latest research that's happening in India, which is, you know, absolutely necessary at this point in time. And also there's another set of people who are trying to tackle misinformation. And this is also happening with the help of data scientists, journalists coming together with data scientists. And as far as your concern, you know, that journalists are not able to get out, the section of journalists who are also going out, what are they doing is they are also resorting to mobile journalism. So that's another way that we have sort of tried to plug in the gaps. If we are not able to get out entirely, what we are getting is we are getting clippings from people. You know, we are talking to people on mobile and we are getting their views online, you know, on our websites, or getting clippings or bites or audio bites even from the populace. You know, for example, if you call up, migrants are giving distress calls. They are putting their videos on social media now. And so what's become, you know, at least a bit easier is that we can reach out to them on social media, we can call them up, we can get their distress signals out, you know, as journalists on our platforms. So that's another way we are sort of trying to plug in those loopholes that you mentioned. Yes, and your concerns are extremely valid, Nidhi. Thank you for bringing that up.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Sahana.
Thanks, Nidhi, for those very pertinent questions. And they are, you know, larger questions in terms of where journalism is going in India, given the current, you know, scenario and given the current government. I'm also very concerned about this quarantine thing, like, you know, because there is a population, middle class or high income class in India where we can afford to be quarantined. But what about the daily wage earners? And I've seen like pictures where there are a lot of like huge lines going from one state to the other. So just wanted to get Subhajoy's take on that in terms of the distress this ban has caused. I know that it is rightly done by the Prime Minister. This is the first step. But given the country's situation and given that 95% of the population lives on informal economy, how do you think, you know, journalism can play a part in this quarantine situation where a lot of daily wage earners are, you know, marginalized, and they are not, I mean, they are already economically marginalized, but now they are at home with no income. So what is Subhajoy's, you know, take on that, Subhajoy?
See, when this was announced, what happened is a lot of migrant workers started to move from one state to another, and what happened naturally is the bus stations, the railway stations, they got crowded with people. So forget about social distancing, it was far worse than what you would see in a normal day. Those things were brought to light by journalists, and then there were instances where the police beat up these poor people, made them do sit-ups on the road because they felt that they have violated the lockdown. And which, when the news, in one instance, this was very, very humiliating. A group of people were sprayed with the disinfectants because they had gone out. And when these when these photos and these reports came out in the paper, even the Prime Minister, who is not very, is not known to be a very kind-hearted man, he even had to tell his officers that no, this is very inhuman. The police has to take a human approach in dealing with these people. And then the government has now issued a guideline, or the Union Home Ministry issued an order to all state governments that no migrant population, no migrant laborers should be allowed to move from the place where they are to any other place. And it is the duty of the government in that place to ensure that they get food, they get place to stay, and they get other needs which they are not being able to generate on their own because they don't have any income now. So it has now been thrust on the local the local government, the state government, the municipal corporations, they have to arrange the place of for these people where they can stay, where they will get food, where they will basically where they can stay till the lockdown is withdrawn or when things go back to normal. Now, I don't know how long this will continue and how they are, how their families are doing way back in the districts, because their families also depend on their income. If their income is stopped, so how will their families run? One of the things that the government has done, as I said, that you, Radhika, you would be aware that many people in India still don't have bank accounts. So one initiative of this current central government was this Jan Dhan scheme, where they encouraged everyone to have bank accounts. So they are transferring some money to these bank accounts, which I believe is going to their families, which they can use that money to buy groceries and other stuff back in their home. But till now, maybe the government has done. I have not really followed whether they have done anything to address the issue of their income. Maybe the local governments are taking care of these people in the places where they are, but what is happening to their families back home, that honestly, I don't know. Shahana, if you know, if you can address that also.
Well, I spoke to some researchers who work on migrant health, and what they told me was basically that although the central government has announced relief measures, but then they don't really know how it's going to reach out to people. So, I mean, we are still, we are not aware of how it's reaching out to people, whether it's being transferred to the bank accounts of their families, which is most likely. But yeah, there are these gray areas that need to be addressed.
Mm-hmm. So you're actually giving me story ideas for future.
I think this is a great discussion to have, to get story ideas and also to get our public concern. My public concern, which I want to raise here, is how do I get a story of a migrant labor, just like, you know, family who's moving from one part to the other? I get the story of the Prime Minister's ban. I get the story of how the Jan Dhan thing is going to work or not work. I get the big picture, but I'm more interested in following a family who is going from one place to the other, and those stories are not being recorded because obviously we can't go outside. Is there a way of, like, you know, either it is socially, you know, marginalized populations, or there's economically marginalized population, or a migrant labor of certain religion going from one place to the other? How do we get those stories out in this time, so that maybe there can be other citizens collectives who can support the government? Like, this is something that my sister's doing in Bhopal. They form, like, and I'm sure they must be having, you know, in Calcutta also, people making food, donating food packets, this, that form, you know, because there's a limit to what the government can do, and the citizens collectives can also support. But till they don't know what the stress, what the problems are, given where, how we are, you know, reading the news on big picture things, they will not be able to support, you know, in the fullest form. So what is the journalism or journalistic community doing to bring those stories out in public?
As I said, that traveling for anyone has been stopped. So even the migrant workers, suppose someone who was trying to travel from North India to South India may have traveled till Central India. That's when they have been blocked, and the union government has told the respective state governments, now it's your duty. You have to give them place to stay. You have to ensure that they give food. You have to ensure that their well-being till the time the lockdown is not lifted. So this is something we know. So within the cities, like, I am a city reporter, within the cities or within the local areas, in the districts, the district reporters, they are reporting which are the places where the government is setting up these facilities for these people to stay, how many people are there. Those information we are getting by talking to government people, like talking to police. What we are trying to do in such a scenario, that the question that she raised is whether we trust one person. What we are trying to do is we are trying to speak to a police person who we know. We're trying to speak to a health department person who we know, who we can trust that, okay, this person will not lie, will give me the correct information. So after talking to 3-4 people, we are trying to gauge on our own, okay, and so then these are the 4 places that have been set up, and these are the 100 people who are staying in each of these places. in that manner. So this information is going out from the print media side. Again, television journalists are going. Television journalists, if they find any migrant laborer walking on the road, they're talking to them. Even print media has reported. In fact, both the Telegraph and Times of India have reported of migrant laborers traveling, talking to them, spoke to them with their pictures. I think in most cases, it would be done through phone, talking to them over phone that I am from this newspaper. I heard that you have been stuck. How they got the phone number, maybe from police, maybe from some NGOs. So this is what we have been doing for many ages. So I think that's how, because even in today's Telegraph, there is a story of a gentleman who has traveled, I think, 1180 kilometers to reach his home. He just cycled from the place where he was walking to his hometown. Now he has finally reached. So this is a print media story. So the journalist managed to talk to that person. I think I'm not sure, but you would be able to throw light on this. In saying case of war situations, which is far more graver than for a journalist to go to. In many cases, what we read in our foreign pages, that the Reuters says that the Reuters could not independently verify whether this is true, but then Reuters spoke to someone in the town who told them that this is happening. So the agencies have read their, say for example, the Reuters reporter is stationed somewhere in Kabul, and then something is happening in a far remote place in Afghanistan. So the Reuters reporter somehow manages to get a phone number of someone who lives in that village, and then there's a ISIS attack or something, talks to that person over phone and then reports, and they clearly write it. This is, Reuters has not been able to independently verify whether this has happened, but this is based on conversation with a villager where this attack took place.
Mm-hmm. So this is the standard protocol given the, if there is harsh circumstances, and of course you can't go there because of safety reasons. We completely agree. In terms of your career as a journalist, Shapachoy, so can you give us some direction, or for our eco ambassadors who will see the video, what type of a person's characteristics and what type of a person should go into journalism? Should he be very brave, or should he be a person who sits on the desk and reads a million papers? What type of a person should go into climate journalism, and especially in COVID? Because I think it really requires person who has maybe altruist thoughts, or maybe wants to do something for the society, or I don't know what does it take to be a journalist during these crisis situation.
I think one of my senior told me right when I had joined this profession is the one quality that a journalist needs is empathy. If you have empathy, you're a good journalist. If you don't have empathy, how much educated you are, how good you write, you're not a good journalist. So I believe that that struck with me, and I believe that was actually right, because all the things we are talking about, what happens to the migrant laborers, what happens to the poor people, what happens to their families, these are all questions that arise from our empathy. So that is the biggest quality you need to have, and ethical. You have to be ethical, you have to be fair. I may be supporter of one idea, one faith, but then when I find that faith is in clash with something else, I have to be fair. I have to say, okay, I may support that faith, but right now I have to be a detached observer and write what has happened and not take sides. I have tried to do that always, but most field journalists I know have tried to do that, but then there will be a very subtle bias inside all of us, so which may be reflected in our stories also. But then in majority of cases, it is possible to maintain the distance and be a detached observer and report. And another thing that for this COVID reporting, this is what the kind of terms we use here in Calcutta in our reporting, this is part of the health bit. So reporters who cover the health issues, this comes under their bit. So what I have believed, I have been covering health issues for some time, because the local municipal corporation here, they have a big role in dealing with health issues like the vector-borne diseases, the tuberculosis, all those things are managed by the local municipal corporation. So what I felt initially, I have read English in my graduate and postgraduate class. So the last time I read science was in school. When I started to report those things, initially it was a little difficult for me to understand the terms, what the a doctor will want, saying things with a lot of terms which I would feel, what does that mean? But then what I felt is, I started following some websites like the Government of India's Indian Council of Medical Research, the Ministry of Health's website. I followed the WHO's website. WHO's website actually has some very good, write-ups, very, very lucidly written, explained for people who are not experts in that subject, who can understand what is it, how this can be prevented, what is an in what circumstances this situation can go out of control. While reporting about dengue, which is a very big problem in tropical country and in India now, every year a lot of people die from dengue here. So I frequently consulted their website. And then what I also did, I have that life science, the topic, we call the subject life science, is biology. So I have that book in my home even now, which we were taught in our class 9-10. So I came back and I used to read those chapters, which I didn't like reading then, but now I actually like them, and because they are somehow linked with the kind of work I'm doing, and now I feel more interested. That helped me. Now, I work for a general newspaper. It's not a, Shahana works for a very specialized news website, which is dedicated very much to science journalism. So her readers will be much more informed, much more people with much more subject knowledge and issue knowledge. But I work for a general newspaper where people will be reading politics, then would be reading sports, in between would be reading city news. So I have to explain to them, see, this is the thing that is happening. These are the measures you need to take. This is what you need to do as a community member to prevent it. This is your responsibility. So for that, I think what we read till in our school, if we reread it, if we just go through it, what we call the refresher course, if we just go through it and then explain it to the reader, that I think that does well for the kind of work I do and for a reporter in a general newspaper. But yes, if I was working for a specialized news website which reports only on science and health issues, because there would be readers who would be researchers in top institutes, doctors. It's not that our paper doesn't have readers who are doctors, but then they would be reading our paper with the objective that I want to read political news, I want to read sports news, I want to read foreign news, I want to read city news and everything, a mix of everything. So I think it helps us to, if I know my, if I have understood and been able to explain things that were taught to me till class, till in school, I will do a fairly good job.
You actually bring up a very interesting point, because a couple of weeks back, we had spoken to a climate activist, and she was saying that unlike what we do at the university, because it's all about, our university is all about cutting edge research and new ideas and new ways of resolving, you know, climate crisis and a lot of research going on. She was saying that, you know, till class 8, whatever we have done, I think is enough science to make a difference in the world in terms of climate science. And you are the same. You are basically saying whatever we have done, reread it again, class 10, 12, go back to, doing a refresher, and then use it practically for things that you see around us, which I feel is really important, which is also linked to the sustainable development idea that we need to bring multidisciplinary research back, and we need to bring multidisciplinary approach back to resolve practical issues. So linking what we have learned to a practical problem that we see around us, I think is a very important take that I get from your talk, Subhajoy.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so Subhajoy, I guess let's turn it around now, and it's not a question as much as you can comment. That, you know, I feel that the Indian government's, I think, policy as far as for now seems successful. And to that extent, would you agree that given that India has such a diverse population and there is such a, there is a huge undercurrent of orthodoxies and religion that runs through the Indian culture, I feel that the current government has played this card really well in terms of selling it almost like a religious activity. right? So there are all these aartis. So people have to light a candle. They have to say namo namo and this. So in that, I feel that, you know, okay, this is one place where they've used this whole religion thing really well and been able to put everybody down. So that's a question. That's a statement. And you can comment on that. That way you must have seen so many people following it so religiously, literally, right? Am I right in thinking that?
Yeah. I would say that I think...
Are you going to be biased or are you going to be unbiased is the question.
No. I will try to be unbiased. I think what the Prime Minister tried to do is do something along the lines of what he saw. He must have seen that people in Italy are doing from their balconies. So... by playing music, but then he felt that by doing some clapping, we would be doing something of that sort here. But then even the Prime Minister had to acknowledge, or at least his party had to acknowledge, that what turned out actually was what not they had expected. People actually came out on the street. There was no social distancing. It had become a national, what do I say? It was like India had won the World Cup suddenly. So people were out on the street celebrating. I don't think even the Prime Minister thought it would be something like that. That's why in his last address, he said, you don't need to go out of your home. You light the diya in your home. You light the candle inside your home. But then these are gimmicks, obviously. We all expected when he was coming to say at 9 a.m. in the morning that he will make some really important announcement, like we are going to extend the lockdown or the economy is crumbling. We are going to take these measures to... better the economy, to pump up the economy, but then there's nothing of that sort. There's no, like, I would say there are some opposition politicians who has said that you are the Prime Minister of my country, you have said that to ask people to do this at this moment, I will not oppose you. I will say, okay, it's a symbolic gesture, I will do that, but there is no science in what you are saying. Please try not to say such unscientific and completely absurd things from the next time. You remember, you're the Prime Minister and people are expecting you to say something more scientific and more sensible.
Okay.
So, I mean, this is absurd. Everyone would agree this is absurd, but then this is the time.
We all know this philosophy, I mean, this thought, but is the journalism group bringing out these stories that this is absurd? Are you going to bring out the story?
Yeah, they are.
In Calcutta, yes, but I don't know in MP.
It's a well-known fact that media is under a lot of pressure in India. Even in Bengal, they are from the state government. It's not that our state government is very liberal and very fair. So if you ask some tough question to the chief minister and the secretariat, the first question that comes back is, you're asking too much, which newspaper you belong to. So it's the same. It's just that she's the chief minister of a state, that is why she's not reported so much in the international media, and he's the prime minister of the country, that is why he's reported in the international media. But then it is being reported, like Scroll, Wire, they're reporting it very regularly. The Telegraph has been going hammer and tongs against this central government, even at times when everyone has remained silent. It is being reported. A section is silent, yes, but then there is a quite a sizable number which is also speaking out. NDTV is speaking out, for which they have to face consequences also, income tax raids against them and everything. So, but it's not that the entire, I would rather say media is being criticized in India so much, but the other institution which is doing worse than media in India is the judiciary, which is completely is the judiciary. How can you have a chief justice? I mean, there should be some positions which are beyond any doubt. How can you have a chief justice who has a complaint of sexual molestation against him, and then he continues his office, he completes his term? I am accused, I set up the committee that will decide who will inquire, he picks up the judges who will inquire whether I was wrong or not, and then we know he has got the Rajya Sabha nomination also.
Well, I mean, at least India is not alone. Even US has Brett Kavanaugh on the
before he got appointed. That's the worst part. We knew he was
exactly there. So I think these are bad times, and Corona only brings out the metaphysics of it. But Radhika, this question is for you, since you mentioned that, you know, universities like Columbia are doing cutting edge research. I would say that I'm extremely disappointed in all these universities that, you know, this corona thing has gone on for too long, and none of the universities who have federal funds, who get funds from across the world, get together the brightest minds supposedly, and, you know, they are completely in a bubble world of themselves, and nobody's come up with anything which is close to a solution.
So there seems to be a debate in terms of the scientists approaching a particular matter, but then they are not given federal funding. Like one of our public health specialists, if you remember, Yanis Benamor, he said that, you know, there are all these epidemics that come up. They have been working on Ebola. They had done all this work in Liberia and Ghana and everywhere. And as soon as the fund, because we are all dependent on the federal funding, NIH and others. As soon as the epidemic comes down, the funding also dissipates. So if we had done that, then we could have done something for COVID-19, because it's the same family of viruses that is, you know, working. And if we had taken a lot of steps when the earlier epidemic was there, and vaccination would have been done, funding just went away as soon as the epidemic got over. So there is this influx of funding. People suddenly now there's this influx of funding on COVID-19. So it's more reactionary rather than precautionary. There is no follow-up from the last epidemic to the current epidemic to the, we know we live in a crisis where there will be health epidemics. We've seen that in so many, like dengue and other places. TB is still going on in India. But it seems to be very funding driven. It doesn't depend on, you know, consistent thought that here is this, here is a policy. I am also very surprised, Nidhi, with the government's lack of planning. There is no approach, there is no framework, there is no WHO guideline that if a country faces a pandemic like this, what are the guidelines that you need to follow? What are the steps that we need to follow? It's all reactionary. So I think it's all intertwined. It has the, you know, the funding situation, it has the scientists who are given funding, not given funding, they move on to other things, and then we get back to the same issue. And then we are again in a similar mess. There is no guarantee after we get, even if we get the vaccination after 2 years, there might be another form of some, you know, virus going on in the next couple of years. Then again, the whole cycle will start. What have we learned from Ebola? What have we learned from SARS-2? What have we learned from, you know, now COVID-19? It's just a spike. People forget, we move on, then another spike, and the countries don't. Then there's a broader question on, do you believe in science? Do you believe that there is this thing? That's again a broader thing that unfortunately we are, you know, living in.
Right. So there are two thoughts to this. One is that, you know, that is why a cutting edge research institute like a Harvard, MIT or a Columbia should be in league with somebody like Bill Gates, who is constantly, or even Jeffrey Sachs for that matter, right? Who is constantly beating the drum that, you know what, COVID is, or a pandemic is not in the horizon. Like if he was speaking in 2015, as Bill Gates said, right? It was nowhere in the horizon, but he knew that is a problem, which is, so that, I mean, that kind of wisdom, that kind of foresight is what is expected of these ivory towers, one. So they should have been pursuing it regardless, which means funding, when you think about the, all these universities sit on a huge corpus of funds, you know, so it is a matter of them also prioritizing wisdom over glamour. So yes, COVID, you know, a pandemic that would not have looked glamorous in 2015 at all, because it had always been a third world country issue, right? So Ebola was largely African, and, you know, even SARS was largely Asian. It hadn't hit the Western world the way it did. So I'm assuming and hoping that this is literally a wake up call for the powers that be in the West to realize there is glamour, there is life, there is funds, everything which is needed. And they will start to do that. And therefore, I feel, you know, that is one place where I'm feeling that these big universities have let us down in not even creating a foresight. They are expected to have the foresight, right? Cutting edge means you are one step ahead of anything that's happening in the world. But I mean, I guess it is what it is. You're right.
give some credit to Columbia University that they started to, we will probably have, you know, the country's only environment school. They are making a climate school separate. So they realize that then again, you know, obviously there is, I think it is a foresight, but of course, the, given where we are, there is obviously, there's a lot of lag in there. But to have a university saying that we will have one school on just, you know, climate and environment, and then all, and bring in all the different people who will work on it, is something of a foresight. With the health pandemic, of course, there have been, again, it has just been a health issue. It never really was like economy issue and like inequity issue and every issue. So it was always like, okay, these people will figure it out. And they figured it out. Ebola was stopped. This one was stopped. That one was stopped. So it never really became this issue that will bring in the whole world and will, you know, capture a lot of the, you know, first world countries. So I really hope that it will become a, you know, this health issue will become a sustainable development issue and will be brought as a forefront, rather than, you know, sometimes these are environment issues done by environment someone. This is done by, you have Jane Goodall who will be doing, you know, her stuff. Greta will be doing her stuff, but these are all interconnected. So I also want to give the credit to Jeffrey Sachs, who has always been, since the Millennium Development Goals, has been saying, bring all these things together, don't work in isolation, health people, work with the education people, make schools as a place to do vaccination. So that approach, if the governments are planning based on that approach, then we will have much more intergovernmental collaboration. Right now, this health issue is not only just hospitals and doctors, it is also migration issue and it is labor issue and so many other things together. So that approach is, the thought is there in the sustainable development goals, but now again, it requires a lot of countries, it requires a lot of funding, it requires a lot of different dimensions, that there will be some weak link somewhere. The research is only a way of starting something, but it has to follow through. It has to go through all the other, you know, the processes and implementation. The implementation links are very weak, as well as the policy links are very weak. So clearly, I think there is a lot to learn from this experience, and we should be able to learn from this, countries, universities, and everyone, to see how we can, you know, bridge this in the future. But a very valid question.
Yeah.
I have one other question kind of along these lines, but thinking about journalism, because I've read some stories, you know, over the past few months about some of the youth climate activists and stuff trying to push the major media companies to not think of climate as its own issue, like you're a climate journalist, but how does climate impact economics, politics, you know, all these other issues, and how can journalists who cover those different focus areas bring climate into it and talk about how it's integrated? You know, one of the theories as to why that's a challenge, especially for the big media companies, is because they rely on advertiser dollars, who are oil companies and, you know, the pharmaceutical companies and all these special interests. So, you know, there's kind of a, the corporations behind those journalism entities don't want those issues maybe covered so much. So I'm just wondering if these are some tensions that exist in India as well, or if there has been a push to kind of integrate climate journalism into other you know, focus areas of journalism, and what the pushback's been.
The same in India. I mean, there are tensions. It's not that there aren't. The big corporate, India, the other big disadvantage is some of the big private corporations own a lot of media houses here in India. Like the Reliance owns a lot of media houses. So it's one of India's biggest private corporation. So this problem is there. I cannot deny that it's very good and very rosy here in India.
So I think we'll have to unfortunately end this call here. It's 11:10, and week. And I think this has been a fascinating discussion. Shubhaja, thanks for being with us and you know, carrying on your work and making sure that you make all the ethical choices and you are objective, and we have a lot of hope in you, and you know that you carry a lot of responsibility because we see the world through your lens. And so it's really important that you are, you know, doing your best, which you are, and given all the challenges and hurdles that the world puts on you. It's great that you are, you know, still smiling and you are working hard and you are going through this whole, you know, episode in such a stride. So thanks for doing all the wonderful things that you are doing, and we will be your avid readers. So keep sending us your posts and we'll get to know more about what things are, how things are in India, and we'll really benefit from reading from your articles. Thank you, Subhajoy, and hope that we continue our discussions, keep sending your articles and keep us in the loop.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was an honor to be in conversation with all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.